Thank you, choir. Incredible. Always good. It's always, as a pastor, it's always good when the choir hits a home run before the pastor gets up to preach. It's just good. And our choir consistently takes us to the throne of grace. I love it. Thank you, choir. Thank you, Pastor Paul, for your leadership. All right, if you could, get your Bibles out. Open up to the book of 1 John. We are crossing our first milestone as we preach through this book. We're crossing into chapter 2. That only took us like 2 months, right? Good. We're going to preach nearly every verse in this text. So I'm excited to be crossing a milestone here into chapter 2. But more importantly, I'm excited to hear when I do hear back from folks. God's doing a work. God has given us this book because He knew we would need it. How many of you remember as a kid when mom or dad put the plate of food in front of you and they want you to clean your plate? How many of you heard that as a kid? Clean your plate. And then you would look down at your plate and you would see something. And it was usually green, right? And you looked down at that and you went, yeah. And then they said, no. Now, I don't know if you're a parent. Maybe you had parents that didn't do this. Mine did. I could not leave the table until my plate was clean. Now, I know that there's some philosophy of parenting that's a little bit different today, because that's mean. You don't that's mean. You don't do that to your children. Now, my mom and dad, they love me, and they love Charlene and I, and today's our anniversary. You've been stuck with me for 18 years. Yeah. Russ Reed, was that you? I didn't even look at you and I knew. Yes. Mom and Dad loved us, and I think these are on behalf of them. So I am not saying my parents were mean. I would never do that when I'm being recorded and videotaped. I would never do that. Never. Never, never. No, but I can remember there were nights where I sat at the table. Everybody was gone. Birthdays would pass. And because there were three swallows of milk, I could not leave the table. My parents did not negotiate with me. Because what they intended to do was put something in front of me that they believed was healthy and good. And that was just how they did what they did. And, you know, we're doing the same thing. And some of that's working out and some of it's not. Many a Brussels sprout sat on my plate for a really long time. I'm just saying. But here's what I want you to know. And because I think the era in which we lived has shifted and changed a little bit. God promised us through the Apostle Paul to Timothy that there would come a time where people, rather than hearing what God had for them, they would instead chase down things that would satisfy their itching ears. We want what we want, right? But God in His Word said, listen, if you will consume these things, all of it, it is a balanced meal. It's nutritious. It's healthy. We can't just kind of skate through, preach through, talk about the things we like. I could preach up every Sunday, talk about heaven every Sunday. That's not equipping you to do the work of the ministry. Now, we need to talk about heaven, right? I mean, we need the reminder that glory is coming and there will be a day where you will not wear gold on your fingers. Your dirty feet will be walking on it. See, that's not to impress you that God paves the street with gold. That's to remind us that gold is nothing to our God. And it's nothing because He is going to pave streets with it like we do asphalt. We need to hear about those things. We need to be reminded of the promise that we have in Christ, because sometimes we just need the reminder, because we're walking and it hurts and there's struggle, and so we just need the reminder of saying, listen, this isn't permanent. There's coming something better. Every tear wiped away, every sadness removed. Those things will happen. But until that day comes, God calls us to be ready. And when I say ready, I don't mean ready for Christ's return. How many are ready for Jesus to come back? Hey, you're ready. Here's the thing. The question is, are you faithful? Because faithfulness implies readiness. if you're not faithful, if we're not faithful as a church to what God has called us to do, you think you're ready. I don't know that you are. I don't know that we are. Faithfulness implies readiness. 1 John is an acknowledgement from God to us that we would struggle in our relationship with Him, that we would have doubts, that we would have questions, that we would have moments where we would literally look up into the heavens and we would say, God, am I? Those days will come. And the hope is that through God's provision, which always comes through His love, that in that provision we have the hope of, if we ever have doubts about our walk with Him, our relationship with Him, doubts about whether our salvation is truly real. God, am I truly going to experience eternal life with You? God just tells us, go to 1 John and read. And the things that you read, these tests that we're going through, God is asking us, are these things modeled in your life? And here's the thing, where these tests, where we don't measure up, where we don't see the reality of these things, God is inviting us to do business with Him, to be reconciled to Him, to repent and have faith, and to say, okay, God, if this test, if I'm not passing the test, God, what must I do to be where You want me to be who You desire me to be? And we've kind of journeyed together in these things. We've looked at who Jesus is, the Word of life, and the promise that we have, that He does in fact want us to know that we have eternal life. Then we talked about walking in the light, and then so walking in the light, not in darkness, in terms of our relationship with sin. That really is that first installment there, beginning in chapter 1, verse 5, just kind of marked the territory for us in terms of our faith and what it means to be in Christ. And of course, the last time we were here and journeyed through the text, we were looking at, are we a people that are acknowledging that we have sin and that we confess sin? Because the text says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So it's important that we acknowledge that we are still, in fact, wrestling with sin nature and our behavior, and we need God to be active and alive in us even today. So today we're crossing, like I said, the threshold into chapter 2, and today we're just simply talking about a test that I'm just calling obedience. Here's what God is saying. Now, we talk about God having an unconditional love for us, and that is true. God's love is unconditional. It doesn't matter what we do. God's love is there, okay? But as we read this text today, what I want you to see and accept that what God is saying to us is, He says this, if you love me, you will obey me. God is going to link for us law and love. He's going to link for us the idea of being in relationship with Him, but that the proof of that relationship, at least as far as this test goes, is going to be bound up in this question. Are we obedient to God and the Scriptures? If we lack obedience, if there's any command in God's Word that we are not obedient to, God is not saying, okay, I'm going to get you. He's saying, okay, this is an opportunity for you to change, to repent, to acknowledge that you're not obedient. But here's the thing. The Bible's going to teach us this morning that if we lack obedience, we're going to lack assurance. If we lack obedience, we're going to lack assurance. Because Jesus Himself made it clear, if you love me, you will obey me. Now that's hard. Because we've grown up and being taught even in our human relationships that we don't put conditions on our love. I just got done sharing. If I walk up to Charlene and I would say, if you love me, you will scratch my back. Now, here's the thing. Does Charlene know that her husband enjoys nails on the back? Yes. So here's the thing. Often I don't have to ask. She just does it because she loves me and wants to not obey me, but wants to please me. So for us, there's not an obedience issue because this relationship is here, okay? And even though I'm the head of the household, that's not an issue of obedience to me. There's some guys getting some back scratches right now. I'm jealous. I'll be down in a minute. Okay. The issue is, and here it is, and this is, we'll get started with this. Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You did not elect him to that position. You did not sponsor him to that position. He was that. He is that. And you are either his subject in salvation or you are outside the family. And if you're outside the family, then God this morning is pleading with you to be in the family, to receive him, not just as Savior. We need to get this right. The Bible says in Romans 10, 9 and 10, that if we will confess with our mouths that Jesus is Master, and by implication we're saying we are slaves. Do you notice the relationship difference? There's this buddy Jesus thing. Jesus is your best pal, JC, and all this other kind of stuff. We need to recognize that God is not someone to be toyed with. The king that we worship will come back riding on a horse. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So as we talk about this, the relationship that we have, and here's the thing, is it good to be friends with the king? It's good to have friends in high places, is it not? I mean, that's just good, right? You didn't get there on your own. You were invited into that relationship by the righteousness of Christ because of his death, burial, and resurrection. He invites us and he says, no longer do I call you servants, I call you friend. But that doesn't negate or change who he is. He is king. And there's no high-fiving the king. There's no fist-pounding the king. There is bowing to the king. There is submission to the king. There is obeying the king. So that's kind of what we're talking about. So maybe even today, it's just maybe the journey for you this morning is this understanding of who Jesus is and who you are. He's here, you're here. And that's never going to change. He's always going to be the king. But because he's the king, he loves you. He loves you. And he wants you to enjoy the security of knowing that your king has done everything required for you to be in his kingdom. I love chains. If you notice on our, if you kind of grabbed this image this image of assurance, we have a chain and this padlock. This is the image of salvation that I want you to capture. Today, as we look at this passage in 1 John, I want you to see some links in a chain. Each one of these things that we're going to be looking through in these six verses are links in a chain. Now, what are chains good for? Securing things. Guys, what would we use a chain for? We've got some guys that don't use chains in the house. Towing something, right? Okay. Why would you use a chain and not a rope? The chain is stronger, right? So here's the thing. If I want to, even if I use a pulley system, if I want to pull something up that's heavy, like maybe an engine or a motor or a piano, or if I'm in a cartoon, a safe, something that I want to eventually not drop on my head, I have some choices. I have a rope. Maybe I've got maybe some other things, but at some level, I've got the option of a chain. I'm probably, if it's heavy like this one, I'm probably going to take the chain. Why? Because it has the ability to sustain and hold the load. Your salvation, my salvation, the assurance we have in Christ is not unlike that chain. No matter how heavy our sin and burden becomes, the chain that is Christ can hold the weight because he is the all-sufficient Savior. So this morning, as we dig in, I want to invite you to stand with me as we read 1 John chapter 2. We're going to read through verses 1 through 6 this morning. I've got them up on the screen. You can follow along there, but please, I encourage you to read in your Bibles. And if that, by the way, when I say Bible, I just don't mean book. If you got a gadget, gadgets are good. Gadget Bibles are good. We like those, okay? These first six verses, and I love the pastoral love and affection that John communicates to his people in this opening sentence. I love this. My little children. Whew, man. I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. And by this we know that we have come to know Him. Here's the test. If we keep His commandments. Whoever says, I know Him, but does not keep His commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps His word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this, we may be sure that we are in Him. Whoever says he abides in Him ought to walk in the same way in which He walked. Let's pray one more time. God, we are nothing if we are not an obedient people. So God, my simple prayer this morning is that we would be an obedient people. God, we know that there is sin in our lives. God, we know that even for those of us who are in Christ, we struggle and battle against our sin nature. But God, even as we learned about that, God, in our last installment, Lord, we are reminded yet today, Lord, that every provision has been made for us. There is nothing we need to do to be saved. You have accomplished it all. But God, for those of us who are in Christ, we acknowledge, admit, we confess that, God, we don't obey to be saved. We obey because we're saved. Obedience, God, is not something we do to earn your love. It is because we have been loved that we obey. So, God, I pray you would soften our hearts. God, tenderize us that we might be obedient to you. God, it comes down to this. We want to make our Father happy. We want to bring a smile to your face. We want our lives to please you, to honor the sacrifice that was made on our behalf. Give us that heart, oh God. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. So, by way of introduction, if you've got your worship program this morning, on the back there's a listener guide. Please take notes. As God speaks to you, maybe jot those things down. Fill in the blanks. It'll help you remember and re-engage later on today or even later on this week. But by way of introduction, we're trying to make some clear statements here. And this one should resonate with us. There is a clear difference between knowing about God and actually knowing Him. You can be a Bible scholar and be lost as a golf ball in the high weeds. And if you saw me play golf, I don't know fairway. All I know is high weeds. Okay? That's all I know. All I know is high weeds. Okay? Obedience, knowledge, these things we're talking about, outside of Christ, they're meaningless. They're meaningless. Okay? But we need to draw this distinction, this line, and I do this from a place of personal experience, being someone who, before they were saved, I had lots of head knowledge. I knew Scripture. I was raised in a church where we were intentionally catechized in the ways of God. So I knew the Lord's Prayer. I knew the Ten Commandments. I could speak to those things. I even had some Scripture. The one thing I didn't have was Jesus. And it just made me a knowledgeable fool because I had no idea what I knew. I knew about God, but I did not know Him. So we want to draw that distinction this morning. And even just here in the introduction, before we go any further, might this be you? Might this be you? You know lots about God, but you wouldn't know His voice if you heard it. Could that be you? The second part of that, if Christ followers are to enjoy a confidence in their salvation, they must understand the relationship between obedience and love. Again, I tried to share in the introduction, don't know that I did it well, but tried to share that we tend to compartmentalize, disassociate, even divorce obedience and love. And God, what He is wanting to do this morning in us and our relationship with Him is marry them and see them as constant companions. So let's look at these links in the chain that John is kind of mapping out for us. The first link I want us to look at here in this really strong chain is just found here in verses 1 and 2. In verses 1 and 2, we're just going to make this simple statement. Obedience to God's commands grows out of knowing deeply who Christ is. Now, here's the thing. I just got done saying knowing about God doesn't save you. Knowing lots about God doesn't save you. But if you are saved, you know some stuff about God. The notion that you can be ignorant of God and be saved is crazy. It's just crazy. To say that I'm saved, but I don't know the gospel, to me makes no sense at all. As Christians, the thing that saves us is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the mechanism, it is the thing by which God has saved us, that we are born lost into sin, nothing we can do about it. Jesus intercedes, steps into humanity, puts on the flesh of humanity, lives a perfect life, a life we could never live, dies a death we could never die because his death pays, and we're going to talk about propitiation here, literally appeases the wrath of God and turns it into his favor for us, right? He does all of that, rises from the grave, out of death, back into life, glorified in everything that God would be. That's how we're saved. Okay? We have to have knowledge of that. So here's the thing. Christian, let me ask you, do you know the gospel? And I didn't really share the fullness of the gospel, but we can articulate it. And those people who are in the story class, Miss Mickey, you're in the story class with me. We understand the gospel. We made up of four basic elements. Creation, fall, rescue, restoration. That is the message of this book. The entirety of the gospel is God created everything. It was perfect. There was harmony. God just provided perfectly for man, loved him, established man in the perfection of paradise there with him. Man sins, and what happens? He ruins everything. He ruins everything. Everything now is corrupted. God kicks man out of the garden. The relationship is broken. But God, even in that moment, makes a promise. I will restore what is broken. He says to Satan, I'm going to crush your head. Yes, you're going to bruise his heel, but the final act, the death blow, will come from the seed of man. And we know that person is Jesus. So we need to understand that, yes, there is a knowledge that we have to have about God and who Christ is, even at the very beginning. Full theological understanding of all the nuances of the gospel? No, although we should have a desire to know them. Okay? The Bible tells us in 2 Peter 3:18, and this was the first passage I ever preached from. We are commanded in 2 Peter 3:18 as Christians to grow in grace and knowledge. It's both. It's not one or the other. It's both. So we can't disassociate and divorce intellectual pursuits here from who God is and from our relationship with him. So our obedience to God's commands grows out of knowing deeply who Christ is. And here's the thing, I cannot think of a better story that illustrates this than what we see in John chapter 8. So here's what I'm going to do. I want you to keep your fingers, your Bible ribbons, whatever you got, tuck it away there in 1 John. And I want you to turn back to the Gospel of John chapter 8. John chapter 8. This is an incredible, incredible story couched here within the very middle of John's Gospel. And it's a story that I think illustrates where we're going with this. For those of you that know this story, it really is a beautiful picture of how God's mercy, how his justice kind of all works together. And I'm not going to read all 11 verses, but as I'm kind of summarizing the story, I want you to read along. Jesus is there. He's teaching in the temple. It's early morning, and there were a great many people who had come down to hear him, and he sat down, and he's teaching them. And in the midst of that teaching, there is an interruption. Sunday school teachers, somebody comes and knocks on your door, right? You're in the middle, Rick, you're in the middle of teaching, right? And there's that knock on the door, and it's Pastor Brad. It happens, right? All the time. It happens all the time. There's this interruption. Well, here's the thing. Jesus is teaching, and there's an interruption. In is brought this woman who has been caught in adultery. It's a horrific, embarrassing scene for everyone. It's uncomfortable. And we don't know really the nuances or the things behind it. Some assume that there was a setup here and the woman was just kind of caught, but she was set up by the religious leaders. We don't know the essence of all of that. But what we do know is this woman was brought before Jesus and she was caught in adultery. And the Old Testament law proclaims that her sin, this being caught, was a death sentence. Okay, this is Old Testament law kind of being walked out. If you're caught in adultery, you were to be brought outside the city and people were going to pick up rocks, big ones. And they were going to stone you until you died. Okay? So this is kind of a tense moment for the woman and probably not for Jesus, but you can imagine being one of the disciples in the room, right? You're going, oh boy. Because we're in Jerusalem, we're at the temple. This is going to have impact and influence as we move forward. So they brought this woman before Jesus, and they say this, and I'll read this, and this comes from verse 4. Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. That is a literal rendering of the Greek. She's been caught in the act of adultery. Now, in the law of Moses, commanded us to stone such women. So what do you say? TikTok. Silence in the room. What do you say? I'm so glad I'm not Jesus. Verse 6, they said this to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. So Jesus, he bends down. He wrote some stuff in the sand, and we don't know what that is, although pastors and scholars certainly spent a lot of time guessing what that was. We just need to stick to the text. What's there is good enough. The silence continues, and finally Jesus just lets this one loose as they continue to ask and to prod. He eventually stands up. And I love how Jesus is in command. They're continuing to ask. He's there playing with the dirt. And he eventually stands up because he's the one in charge. He always is. And he finally issues these words. Let him, notice the gender tense, let him who is without sin among you be the first one to throw a stone at her. And once more, he bent down and wrote on the ground. What more can you say? It says there in verse 9, but when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones, down to the younger, and until finally the room is empty. It's just Jesus and this woman. And Jesus stands up again. He's the one in charge, even over the woman, right? And he says, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? And she says back to him, no one, Lord, love that. She calls him master. And then Jesus replies, neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more. This story highlights three things that we're going to see patterned, not only in this text, but in our text in 1 John. Three things. The first thing Jesus highlights is the sinfulness of all mankind. How does Jesus do that? Well, we have the woman, right? That one's obvious. Jesus is, you know, again, he's there in the room and he's writing in the sand, writing in the dirt, right? And he says, okay, he who is without sin, cast the first stone. What is he doing? Let me retranslate. You're all just like her. You have no right to throw stones because you're just like her. You see, in bringing her into the room, and even in bringing her into the presence of Jesus, there is an act of piousness that cannot be overlooked. The men bring her before Jesus and into the temple area, and they say, she is a sinner. We're supposed to stone her, Jesus. What are we going to do? And Jesus says, yeah, we can do that, but there's got to be rocks for you. And by the way, the only one good is God, so really I'm the only one who has the right to throw stones. Now here's the thing, and I want us to be careful here. Jesus is not negating the woman's sin. He's not lifting up the rug and sweeping it under. That's not what he's doing. All he's doing is saying, everybody in this room is a sinner. Everybody in this room is condemned to death. Everybody in this room deserves what you are about to do to this woman. Let me bring this forward. You deserved the stoning that she was about to receive. You, all of us do. We do. I do. We all deserve what this woman was lined up to get. Every single one of us. So Jesus is first saying the sinfulness of mankind, this is universal, from the woman to the most pious Pharisee in the room. The second thing that he points out is in this story that John kind of, as he tells the story, is the wideness of not only God's mercy, but how those things happen in and through Jesus' intercession. Catch this. Jesus extends forgiveness even to those who commit crimes that are punishable by death. That's pretty good. Let's talk about that for a minute. According to the scriptures, there is no division between death sentence sins and lesser sins. Now, there are some traditions that do that. Some traditions call them mortal sins and venial sins. That's not biblical. From the greatest sin to the smallest sin, they are all punishable by death because God demands perfect righteousness from his people. So every sin falls into this death sentence category. So wait a minute, even an impure thought, same sentence from God, even to the one who actually is committing egregious acts of evil, maybe equivalent to what we have seen historically from people like Hitler or Chairman Mao Zedong or Ho Chi Minh or whoever? Yes, God has us all on a level playing field, and we're all guilty. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of God's glory. And it's not, we're the ones that attach, think, you know, this is worse, this is better. God doesn't do that. All sin is punishable by death. Okay, but there is a wideness in God's mercy and that comes through the intercession of Christ. And of course, we see that in the woman. Lastly, number three, John highlights the righteousness of Christ. We've been talking about his light and the necessity of those who follow him are to walk in that light. To the woman, he said what? He said, go and do what? Stop sinning, i.e., what you were caught doing, you're guilty. Stop it. I had to tell my daughter that this morning. Stop it. What I didn't do is say, stop and sin no more. I didn't do that, but we'll get there. In 1 John chapter 2, again, the same author, John wrote the gospel. He wrote this first letter. Flip back now to 1 John. Let's go back to chapter 2. We have these same three themes just mapped out in a different order. First, we have John's version here, again, in this epistle, where he says, in a sense, echoing the words of Christ, sin no more. Look at what he says. I am my little children. There's that pastoral, I love you, you're my kids kind of thing. I am writing these things to you so that what? You may not sin. Here's the thing. Just because sin might be inevitable doesn't make it excusable. Are you tracking with me there? Just because you and I have a sin nature doesn't mean we can come before God and go, well, I got a sin nature. Sorry. That's wrong. Okay? Sin might be inevitable, but it is never excusable. And praise God, it is always forgivable. So, my little children, I'm writing these things to see they may not sin. Just like the woman, Jesus telling all his people, I don't want you to sin. I want you to be avoiding sin at all costs. Next in the text, again, we have this understanding of the wideness of God's mercy that is available according to the text, for all people, but especially Christians. John, again, he's writing to Christians. What does he say? He says what? I'm writing so that you may not sin, but if anyone does. The anyone, that's as good as all, right? If anyone does sin, if any of you, if I sin, we have this wideness of mercy that is inclusive, that is expressed in something we can enjoy. But then there is this third mark here, tagging along with God's mercy, that sinfulness of all mankind, even Christians, that we have this ongoing work. See, we have an advocate. We are promised that Jesus Christ is our advocate with the Father. When Jesus died on the cross, he said what? Tetelestai, it is finished. But that doesn't mean that he is finished with us or you. And it doesn't mean that you and I are finished battling against our sin. You see, all the work that Jesus needed to do on the cross was done. But even now, for you and for me, Jesus is serving as our advocate with the Father. Why? Because we need one. I need a good defense attorney. And I love in our particular system of justice here in the States, you know, you have a right to an attorney. And if you can't afford one, we will give one to you. But here's the thing. In that circumstance, if I cannot afford an attorney, I'm just going to get the one I get, right? I don't get a lot of choice. You and I get the best defense attorney in the universe to defend our case against our sin before the Father. Yes, all our sins are forgiven, and Jesus continues to minister and to advocate our case in His righteousness for our sake and for His glory. Between these two things, between the story in John 8 and here we have there in 1 John 2, do you see the balance here? Did you see the connection and the web that Jesus is laying out for us? It's the same balance, one to the other. And it's here that we find a serious, realistic, and merciful view of sin. Sin might be inevitable. It's never excusable. Yet in Christ, it is forgivable. And of all the names that we have in the Bible that refer to Christ, and you can probably sit here and rattle them off. We can go to whole sections of Scripture where names and titles of Jesus are rattled off. King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. John here adds another advocate. And like any defense attorney in a court of law, Jesus is testifying before the throne of God in our favor, against our sin and its due punishment. So who is Christ? If we're going to know Christ, if that's our first link in the chain, we have to answer this question, who is Christ? For the adulterous woman in John 8, and for us today, He is our advocate. And He is our eternal advocate for our sin on the basis of His work on the cross. And again, let's talk about the word propitiation for just a minute. This word in the Greek, it's halasmos. And if you have a modern translation that maybe is a bit more readable, it'll say atonement for sin or sacrifice for sin. That's a decent rendering, but it doesn't capture what this word does. The Greek word is halasmos, and it literally means a sacrifice that bears God's wrath and turns it to favor. It's not that Jesus and His death on the cross just makes God's anger and wrath go away. It's replaced with favor. God isn't brought to a zero-sum balance. For those of us who are in Christ, God is happy with you. Some of you need to hear that this morning. God is not angry with you anymore. Because of Christ, He looks at you with a smile. Not because He's unaware of your sin. He's aware of it. But it's been dealt with. God's wrath and anger have been satisfied by Christ. And all of that wrath and all of that anger has been put on Christ. And now when God looks at His sons and daughters, He has nothing but favor for us. Is that good news? You have to know that. If you are in Christ, that must not be just a tapestry on the wall. That's it. That's the gospel. Those are the things we must know and understand. But I would argue once more time that knowing is not enough. Those things represent a beginning. So let me just ask you, do you know those things? Do you believe those things? And then as we transition to the next link in the chain, have you experienced them? The gospel is just not something to know. It's something to obey and to experience. Verses 3 and 4 represent the second chain, the second link in the chain. Obedience to God's commands begins with a deep knowledge of Christ, yes. The second link is obedience to God's commands. We're flipping the coin. It is the ultimate proof that we truly know Christ. It's our obedience that is the proof of our identity in Christ. So, book of 1 John, what's it about? Church, what's it about? Assurance. It's about confidence. It's about knowing that we know that we are God's children. There's no other book in the Bible that deals with this subject in this way. The theme of knowing, believing, and having the assurance that you and I are in Christ. And this little epistle, this short letter, this verb to know, it's the Greek word gnosko. In this short letter, we see it and its derivatives as many as 40 times. And the first of these occurs in this text. You have to get to chapter 2 before you see this to know. So we have this great theme, and this language is used here. Look at the beginning of verse 3. And by this we what? We know that we have come to know him. And then the second half of verse 5, the act is bookends. And by this, it says, the second half of verse 5, it says, and by this we may be sure that we are in him. These are sharp statements, but it is 3 and 4 that provide the meat of the test that is before us this morning. And the first thing we need to take account of is that this is not some obscure element that John is tossing into the fray. In fact, John is simply echoing the words of Christ. Look at John 14, 15. Jesus' words, before he is arrested, there is a section of John's gospel where it is Jesus, literally, fire hydrant. He's unloading on the disciples. And here in verse 15, look what Jesus says. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Now, we're going to talk about how this relates to love here in just a little bit when we get to verses 5 and 6. But I wanted you to see the link in the chain. The words of Christ that John echoes. If you love me, you'll obey my commandments. And here, John is introducing us to two kinds of people. Some of you, you know these words. There's two kinds of people. There's the talker, and then there's the walker. The talker is the one who says they know Jesus, but they don't live a life of obedience to Jesus. And then there are the walkers. They say they know Jesus, but the proof of their knowing him is borne out in their obedience to him. Look at what verse 4 says. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Do you hear the talker being shut down in that verse? Do you see it? Do you hear it? The person who is just the talker, who just says, I know God, but is not living a life of obedience, John says, and this is God speaking through the apostle, God says that person is not in the truth. That person is a liar. We do not know Christ if that is who we are. We are outside. Again, according to what we're reading here, proof that our relationship with him is genuine is determined by our personal obedience to Christ's commands. Now, is that obedience going to be perfect? No, that's why we have an advocate. We always go back to that. But we struggle, we battle. And here's the thing, it's not about try. It's not about Christianity. The Christian walk is not about trying. It's about dying. It's about dying to self. It's about denying ourselves and following Christ. Now, we're about to get into some details and specifics about this when we talk about, again, relationship, love, and law. But I don't want anybody to miss this here. What John is addressing is not simple knowledge about God or just having an intellectual knowledge of God. This is intimacy. That word gnosko is an intimate word. It goes beyond just the simple knowing. It's a knowing that changes life. It's a knowing that lends itself and leads to obedience. We can't escape this. We can't go around it, over it, or through it. We just have to live it. James said it this way in James chapter 2. Look at this. So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, what does it say? It's dead. Now, there were some, and Martin Luther included, who thought that James was in conflict with Paul. And when they were putting together the Bible for, you know, after the Reformation happened, Luther was on the side that maybe James shouldn't be included because he saw the conflict. I see no conflict here. There is no conflict here. Faith without works is dead. A declaration of faith without the evidence of obedience is empty. It's hollow. It's a shell. It has no substance. If all you and I have is a statement of faith, but there is a lack of obedience, not perfect obedience, but a struggle for obedience, if that's our reality, then James is telling us that what we say and maybe even what we think is not enough to convict us because our faith is dead. The proof of our being in Christ, the evidence enough to convict, is going to be in our lives. So Christian, speaking to you, because that's who John is speaking to. Christian, hear me when I ask you this question. Is there any area of life, great or small, where you are not obeying him? Is there any area of your life where you are not obeying Christ? Now here's the thing. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but every hand should go up. Because to deny that we have no sin, see, here's where these connect. If we say we're fully obedient to Christ, what we're saying is we have no sin. And what did John say about that in chapter 1? If we say we have no sin, we what? We deceive ourselves. So the answer to the question I'm asking, is there any area of life where you're not obeying Christ? If you are answering yes to that right now, in your pride, your arrogance, or in your ignorance, today is your day to be confronted with the reality that you have areas of your life where you are not obeying the King. No matter how great or how small, we have those things in our lives. We have areas of life we are not obeying. How do they express themselves? Well, maybe there's broken relationships that need mending. You know, withholding forgiveness is a sin. You know, when we serve the table, if you're like in conflict with people, if you're just ignoring someone, like because you have broken relationship, that stuff's unsettled, you are drinking judgment upon yourself. You should be refusing the body and blood of Christ when those things are past. Divisions are not to be tolerated and accepted within God's church. Maybe it's not a broken relationship. Maybe there's something you're doing that needs to stop. This would apply more so to us than other things. Maybe there's something we need to start. See, sin isn't just the bad stuff we do, it's the good stuff we don't do, right? I don't know what it might be in your life, but here's the thing. Today is the day to begin reconciling and repenting before God to settle those things. That will be evidence. Remember, God will convict his kids. He'll do it, and we need to respond. The last link in the chain, verses 5 and 6, obedience to God's commands is a matter of love and not just law. So far, if we were to stop here, there might be some folks who walk out of the room going, heavy, mechanical, sure. Maybe somebody would even say legalistic. And I know it tends to sound that way, but I want to assure you this is not legalism. Obedience is not legalism. Here's where we need to understand what the word legalism means, because I hear that word tossed around, and sometimes it's right and sometimes it's not. Legalism is defined this way. When we define obedience as the means by which we gain God's favor, that's legalism. When we say that obedience is above grace, that's legalism. Obeying God is not legalistic. That's just holiness. Okay? Now, if you're obeying God to earn his favor or to keep his favor, you're out of step. And we need to realize and recognize that it is only grace that grabs us and keeps us, right? It's only grace that does that. Again, we don't obey to earn God's love or to keep God's love. We obey because we have been loved. So neither Jesus nor John is teaching us that obedience will save us. We can keep God's law and still come up short. The only thing that gets us across the finish line is God's grace in Christ alone. Obedience never saves, never has. Jesus' obedience, however, does save. He was obedient even unto death, even death on a cross. So what I want you to see in this final link in the chain is that because we have been loved by God, a natural response, an outflow, will be in turn to love him back. When somebody loves you, and here's the thing, you know what it is to be loved. Most of us know what that is. You know what it is to be loved and loved well, right? Okay? Some of you may know that more than others, right? But you know what it is to be loved. You know what it is to feel that, to experience that, right? What's the normal response? And when I say normal, I put the quotes up because I'm not normal, so I can't say that. But what would be the normal response? If you've been loved well, how do you respond? You want to love back. If we've been loved well by God, what should our response to that be? To what him back? And what does he say loving him is? If you love me, what? Okay. Isn't it, what I think is incredible is God says, if you want to know how to love me, here it is. He doesn't make us guess. He doesn't make us wonder. So, okay, Peter, that was one verse in John 14. You're hanging a lot on that one verse. Okay. John 14, 23, Jesus answered him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. John 15, 10, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. So we're not dealing with obscure passages here. We're hanging this on large hooks. Now, there's going to be somebody in the room going, all right, I get it, I'm convinced. Which commands are we talking about here? Because I want to make my list. That's a great question. Which commands are we talking about here? Well, you can say all of them, and maybe there would be some good there, but let me just break this out. If we were to examine the Gospels, most scholars are able to identify about 100 separate and distinct commands that Jesus gave that cover categories such as our relationship to God, to Jesus, our neighbor, and the household, as well as our personal character. That is what we are to think, say, and do. That's 100. How many of those can you rattle? Just spit. Probably not many, and I couldn't either. Here's the thing. You want a good kind of flow for that? Go to the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7. The Sermon on the Mount will give you a good pattern and pathway to at least get your hands around, your mind around some of that. Now, if you were to broaden your scope out to the Old Testament, you're going to discover there are 613 separate commands that God's people are to obey. Does that overwhelm you? How many of you are looking, okay, Pastor, 613, where's my list? The ushers need to be passing out some paper right now, right? We need to see that happen. No, Jesus has a way of taking the complicated and simplifying. You ready? Matthew chapter 22, verses 36 through 40. Here it is. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And he said to him, ready? You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart and all of your soul, with all of your mind. Mark's gospel adds strength in that passage. This is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Verse 40 is the key for us. On these two commandments depend or hang all the law and the prophets. Here's the thing. Have we been talking about the great commandments now here at Crossroads for a while? We're never going to venture far from this territory. Loving God supremely, loving others sacrificially. If we will do those things, you will never have to wonder which commands you're keeping, which ones you're not. Here's how you approach this. In what I'm about to do, whatever that is, how do I loving God supremely and how am I loving others sacrificially? You mean we need to live our lives that way? Yeah, pretty much. Because on those two things, Jesus says the entire law depends. We refer to these commandments as the great commandments because it is literally taking all of the law, all of God's holiness, and boiling it down to two simple statements. Do you see the connection? Love and law are joined together, not as bitter enemies, as if they don't have anything to do with each other, but as constant companions. I love people ask, well, Pastor, is it law or grace? Yes, it's both. We are saved by grace through faith, and that not of ourselves. It is Christ, not by our own works, right? That's Ephesians 2, 8, 9. But he saves us to be holy, and you want to understand what holiness is, then you have to understand the law. It's not an either or, it's a both and. They are companions, not enemies. They're not to be divorced. They are to be brought together. By the way, did you notice that loving God is a command? When he's asked, what is the greatest commandment? What does Jesus say? Love God. It's a command. Love others. It's a command. You know what? As God's children, we're going to do? We're going to obey our Father. Because we know what has been done on our behalf. When you join these two things together, and then you link them to the Great Commission, which I believe is the primary means by which we fulfill both parts of the commandments, our mission as a church and as Christ followers, they're there in all their beauty. What's our mission? We exist to love and glorify God by doing what? Making disciples of all nations, one life at a time. Look at how the final verse here in our passage wraps all this up. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk. And ought, by the way, is a moral implication. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. How did Jesus walk? We're not talking about did he limp or not. We're not talking about that. How did he walk? What did he spend 3 years doing? He spent 3 years obeying his Father, and it culminates like on the death of the cross, and we get that. But what did he spend 3 years doing? Building a legacy that you and I are enjoying even now. A legacy where he takes three men and pours into them in a way that you and I may never understand the intimacy that Peter, James, and John had with Jesus. But then there was that larger group of 12 that were just known. They just moved Jesus in the middle, his primary team, home team, Jesus boys. That's what they were. Wherever he went, they went. What he ate, they ate. Just whatever he said, they repeated. They just went together. Right? And then we know there was a larger group of 70 and 72 that Jesus would ultimately send out by twos into the world, into the communities, and they would do incredible ministry. And then we know from 1 Corinthians 15, there was a group of 500 disciples that Jesus would appear to at one time before he would ascend. Now here's the thing. We live in an age where we are really impressed with big churches. I don't know why, because at the end of Jesus' ministry, what we have is a church of about 500. You would think Jesus would build a church of thousands. Oh, he drew crowds of thousands, but when you expose thousands to the light of the gospel, they scatter. And what you're left with is the faithful. What you're left with is the remnant. What you're left with are those people who love God with all of their hearts, souls, mind, and strength, and who love each other and want to turn the world right side up for the cause of Christ. That's the gospel. Church, can I just say something I've said, I think, 1,000 times? The Christian life is not sitting in church. The Christian life is not coming to church. If the only thing that has changed in your life is your Sunday schedule, you are not living the Christian life as God intended you to live it. The Christian life is going to consume you like a fire that a lot of gasoline has been poured on. It's going to change how you work. It's going to change how you talk. It's going to change how you think. Yep, it's going to change how you vote. It's going to change how you see the world. It's going to change how you see your enemies. It's going to change how you love. And the first thing that's going to change about what you love is God. Because we all come to Christ initially as someone who is hostile and hates God in our lives. And he changes our affections to where we love him. So the question is, do we love him? That's a good gospel question, isn't it? Do you love him? The evidence of your love for Christ will be in your obedience to his word. You can't get away from this. You can't say, I'm a Christian and do whatever you want. If that mind is in you, I would submit to you, do not leave here until you are right with God. Because I think that thinking is wrong with God. Say, Pastor, you're judging me. No, I'm not. God's word is. And it's judging me too. I have to assess and do an inventory of my life, my marriage, how I live, how I serve, and what I do, and the things I don't do. If I'm not obeying God in those things, then I have no right to confidence in heaven. Jesus died. He died for you, not to keep you the same. He died to change you. He wants to change you. There's a song we sing, "Come Just As You Are." Jesus doesn't invite us to come as we are so that we'll stay that way. He comes and he invites us to come because we are grotesque and he wants to make us something beautiful. And that's going to require some changing. But I'll tell you, you can't change you. Oh, I know willpower and try harder and yeah, you'll fail. We all do, right? So here's my thing. What if we take try off the table and we put die on the table? If we will die to self, we will deny self, all the work that God wants to do will be done, and he'll do it in his time and his way, but he'll do it. Christian, hear me when I say this to you. If you lack assurance or confidence, is it because you're not obeying? Is it because there's sin in your life? Is it because there's things maybe you're not doing that you know you should be? People, if you are outside of Christ, if you know you're not a Christian, you know the gospel is something to be obeyed. My encouragement to you is that you would obey the gospel, that you would repent and believe. That's what you have to do this morning. And let God do those initial works in you. And the waters of baptism will be there because that's the first step of obedience, isn't it? Here's the thing. That's obedience. We have two people who just displayed the message for us this morning. If you love Jesus, you're going to do what he tells you to do. And the first step is what? Be baptized. Isn't that a beautiful picture? Isn't that good? Y'all preached a message I could never preach. Thank you. Let's pray together. Father, as we close our time together this morning, Lord, I ask that, Lord, as we just take a few minutes, God, there's maybe some business that we have to do with you. There's repentance that has to happen. There's confession that has to happen. God, maybe there's someone in the room who doubts, who questions, and God, your word declares that you want us to know, you want us to have the assurance that we are in Christ. But God, if we don't have obedience, then Lord, we're not going to have assurance. And God, we know you've made provision. We know we're not going to be perfect. We know we have an advocate. You've made every way for us. We have no excuse. If we confess our disobedience, we confess our sin, God, you say you are faithful and just. God, I truly believe that revival starts here. A movement of your spirit that cannot be stopped begins here. God, make us, teach us, show us what it means to be obedient. God, link these pieces of this chain together. God, that you might sustain us and hold us up, that we might not fall. God, if there are people here who need to make decisions, God, need to make commitments, maybe to you, maybe to Crossroads, whatever it is you're leading them to do, God, I pray they would be obedient to do it. Find us faithful, Lord, in these next couple minutes as we respond to what you've said. Lord Jesus, move in this place by your Spirit. We ask it in your name. Church family, would you stand with me? We're going to just sing a song of commitment this morning. Pastor Brad and I are going to be here at the front. We would love to talk with you, pray with you about your relationship with God. If you want to share struggles that you have, maybe you need to come to the front and pray. Families, maybe you need to come to the front and pray. Maybe you don't need to come front. Maybe you need to do some side business. Maybe the repentance that needs to happen is not just you and God, but maybe you and someone else. Do business this morning. Don't miss this opportunity. Pastor Paul, would you lead us?